Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm John Abbott, president of GBH, and I want to thank you for joining us today for this special opportunity to talk with legendary filmmaker Frederick Wiseman about his 45th film, City Hall. Named by the New York Times as one of the best films of 2020, it's about the inner workings of our own Boston City Hall and features Mayor Marty Walsh and his dedicated staff. We're very proud to present the television debut of Fred's new film on GBH2 next week on Tuesday, December 22nd at 8 p.m. Mayor Walsh and Fred Wiseman will soon be joining me, but first, we'd like to begin by giving you a look at the film with a few clips. The film is more than 4 hours long, but we'll try to give you a feel for it in the next 4 minutes. This is City Hall.
How do we tell the story about what's happening here? Like, what's the story that Boston's trying to tell?
We have great prosperity in the city of Boston right now, and one out of every six Bostonians is struggling with food insecurity. We need to work together to tackle this issue to get that number to zero.
There is no doubt that there are disparities that exist, and there are systemic barriers and policy barriers, and we want to address them.
In my years of being president of NAACP, there was never this much focus on being involved in civil rights.
The intersection of VFW Parkway and LaGrange Street in West Roxbury, the traffic signal was out. Yeah, I just want to confirm that you had it.
I have a constituent that's asking about road maintenance. Is it okay if I put him through?
Is it a stray dog?
Yeah, she said she couldn't see a visible cause, like there was no down wires or anything, but the whole block appears to be out.
If you're not getting a response, my advice, two things. Number one is call your complaint into 311, and if you see me on the street, grab me and tell me what the problem is.
What do you want, ma'am? Some more people got to have something.
How do you take your expertise and take it out to the community and give people opportunities? Our job is to represent and support the people of Boston.
The impact can be made locally, and all it takes is one city.
So we just got a call from Boston Fire reporting a one alarm fire at 33 Browning Ave in Dorchester, and there's no displacements at this time.
Just wait one moment while I do some research for you.
I'm gonna open up a case for Parks, the Parks Department. They deal with trees.
We got a call from Boston Police. The intersection of VFW Parkway and LaGrange Street in West Roxbury, the traffic signal was out. Yeah, I just want to confirm that you had it.
This is my favorite part. Just as this ring. Encircles your finger. So does my love.
Encircle your heart.
My heart. Now you can place it on her finger and say, With this ring.
I thee wed.
Okay. Molly's turn. Just as this ring. Encircles your finger.
So does my love.
Encircle your heart.
Now with this ring.
I thee wed. Perfect. Inasmuch as Becca and Molly have exchanged rings, have consented to matrimony, and vows, by the authority vested in me by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, I now pronounce you married. Mm-hmm. Here we go. Stand together, okay? Mm-hmm. All right, smile. All right, let me show you what we've got.
As usual, it's busy night last night on Halloween, and just be aware of any kind of violence that might extend from it. Town's in a warrant, there's a firearm recovered at 7 p.m. with an arrest. There was a person shot and stabbed at 137 Center Street. There was a large party of a couple hundred people. Full notes on the person shot, but they're probably going to survive. The gang unit then had a car chase through H Block of Bailey Associates, so be aware of that. And around 3 a.m. this morning, the K car got a firearm arrest in Upham's Corner. And that was I don't know if it's related, but there was a violent assault up there that was the reason why people were up there, and it led to a firearm arrest up on, over to the C-11 side.
Any issues? Concerns? We check your assignments. Let's have a good day. All right, follow. You?
No, I didn't go to the door.
All of us, as you get older, you take prescriptions for high blood pressure, for cholesterol, whatever it is you have. And it's important that we understand there's more health risks as you get older because the body breaks down a little bit. So there's more chance that you're going to be on a prescription as you get older. And we need to make sure that that's covered. So the answer is we have to look legislatively at fixing that. One of the reasons why we have the Elderly Commission is to advocate on your behalf. The people that work for the city work for you. Well, they're there to service you. So take advantage of that opportunity. Take advantage of that office. Ask questions. They'll get the answers. And if we got to a point where, what I'd like to do is get to a point where the Elderly Commission, that I'll have to double the size of the Elderly Commission because the amount of calls they get. And believe it or not, we don't get that many calls. We get a lot of calls, but not as many as there are people in the city of Boston that are over 60 years old. So we'll get the budget there, but we need you to use the office, because I'd rather you talk to one of the specialists we have and get a benefit than be taken advantage of. So that's why they're there. They're there for you. They work for you. Our primary purpose is to help people with the situations you might have. So please call them.
Welcome, Mayor Marty Walsh, joining us from, of course, Boston's City Hall. And welcome, Fred Wiseman, who's joining us from his home in Paris. We're thrilled to have you both here. And for many years, of course, public media has been working with Fred, and we've been the broadcast home for Fred's films, primarily focused on important American institutions. And one of the roles that GBH and all public media fulfills is helping to enable democracy by informing citizens about local issues and giving access to elected officials. As many people who may be joining us for this event know, Mayor Walsh appears on GBH's call-in program, Boston Public Radio, giving citizens the opportunity to directly ask questions. He does that regularly. So this is a familiar opportunity we have with Mayor Walsh, and we're really grateful for that opportunity to pair him with Fred as we shared a little bit of City Hall with you. And that leads to my first question for Mayor Walsh. Mayor Walsh, this film shows how much access that everyday people have to you and how present you and your staff are around the city of Boston in so many ways in people's everyday lives, in neighborhoods, in food pantries, community halls, and more. And it struck me while watching all the events and meetings in the film, all of those events were filmed in 2018 and 2019. And of course, now we've been through this COVID lockdown for 9 months. This must have changed your manner of governing and your approach to staying connected to people quite a bit. Can you talk a little bit about that?
It certainly did. I mean, when I was thinking about before, first of all, John, thank you for having us today. And it's great to be on. Anytime I get a chance to spend some time with Fred, it really is amazing. He's an amazing filmmaker, but he's an amazing person. And I want to thank him and congratulate him on all the accolades. It's not so much about the fact that City Hall is being highlighted is great to see, but Fred's career has been amazing. And what he's been able to do here and reading the reviews, Fred, as I've said to you in the past, congratulations and well-deserved, my friend, well-deserved. You know, when you think about this film that people are going to be watching next week and they're going to see this, it is pre-pandemic. And it's kind of looking at the way we used to govern. And I think that what we're doing now is creating a different type of government and how we're going to be able to have to govern, not just during the pandemic, but how we're going to be governing into next year and maybe beyond that. And it's very different. I mean, everything that we're seeing, lots of events, lots of people, community meetings, people in congregating. All of that changed. All of that changed in March. It all went to Zoom. It went all online. We didn't see all of that. So it's really making me think about, you know, how do we bring back that connection with people that is so prevalent in the film? The access that people have to government, not necessarily to me, but to government, and to me, but to government on different levels. So we do have to be very cautious and thoughtful about as we move forward here to keep that connection there for people to be connected to their city government.
Well, you mentioned, Mr. Mayor, you mentioned access. And speaking of access, Fred, you had extraordinary access to the mayor and to City Hall for 10 weeks, and you recorded over 100 hours of footage, if I have that correctly. How did you decide what to cover? And alongside that, Fred, getting that much material and choosing where to be with the mayor, with his team, in the workings of government, what surprised you?
Well, I'll take the second question first. Everything surprised me because I knew absolutely nothing about city government or Boston city government. I had studied political science in college. That was both a long time ago, and it was the experience of being in City Hall, having access to the mayor, visiting the various departments, going out with building inspectors or restaurant inspectors or participating in community meetings, gave me a real sense of how the activities of City Hall and the mayor and the people who work at City Hall touch every aspect of our daily lives, much more so than any other form of government, whether state government or federal government. Birth, death, marriage, parking, public health, police, fire, on and on. And how the activities of City Hall represent the contract between the city and the citizens. And whereby minimum standards of behavior are agreed on, and if those standards are violated, either there are civil or criminal penalties. So the film is a study of the contract between the citizens and the city.
And you had, Fred, you had a lot of choices of things, in the end, a beautiful array, a wonderful revealing array of aspects of the city's responsibilities to its citizens. But how did you choose which of those moments to focus on? I mean, you had 100 hours, and I know you made a lot of choices, but what were some of the things you were looking for in trying to figure out what frame to give to the role of City Hall?
Well, as I said, I didn't know anything about City Hall, so I don't know anything about most of the subjects my films before I start. And it's always a combination of instinct, luck, and some good judgment. I've learned over the years to sort of try and follow my instinct. And I mean, I knew that I wanted to spend time with the mayor. I knew that I wanted to spend time with the heads of the various agencies, that I wanted to hang out in the corridors of City Hall just to see what was going on. And that I wanted to spend a little time with some of the principal agencies like the police and the fire department. But I never know in advance what the content of any particular sequence will be. So I've learned to follow my judgment for good or bad. And I know that in the shooting, my job is to collect sequences and not to think about structure or point of view. And that I find that later in the editing. And my job during the shooting is just come away with a feeling, when I finish the shooting, I have the feeling out of 100 hours, I ought to be able to cut a film.
Well, you used two words there, Fred, instinct and judgment. So let me turn to the mayor. Mr. Mayor, how did it affect the day-to-day of governing when Fred is recording with you and your team every day? How did you wrestle with what he had access to, and kind of how did that affect the, you know, you've got so many things you're managing with your team, and this renowned filmmaker comes in and says, you know, I'm going to spend 10 or more weeks looking in on the things you're doing. How did that affect with your instincts and your judgment, how did that affect your governing?
You know, it didn't really impact it at all, because after the first, Fred, I don't know if the first scene of the movie is actually the first day of your filming.
I think it was, yeah.
It that might have been the only time that I recognized or was cognizant that Fred was in the room. Other than that, I knew him and his team were there. There's only three of them, but they were part of the team. Like they just we didn't say certain things because he was there. We did not say certain things because he wasn't there. We just spoke and we had our meetings. And I think you see it throughout. You see the honesty throughout the film of people just talking and saying what they say. And I think that you know, Fred has had access to almost everything. There's been a couple of meetings he didn't come into in here with me, in the mayor's office being meeting in here. I think other than that, he'd go wherever, and he didn't have to explain that better. But I mean, I told people just be yourself, and nobody said, no one came into me, oh my God, you know, Fred Wiseman, this happened in the meeting, and Fred was there filming. None of that ever happened. And I think that the movie being so genuine, that's what makes it so unique, is that it wasn't scripted. Nothing was scripted. Like nothing was scripted. And I know that people are saying, oh, you know, if there's a main character in the movie, it's me. I would push back against that. I would say the main character in the movie are the people that work with me every day and the people that were in there. So, because every clip is a different scene, and every clip could have been a movie, if you will. Whether the clips we saw in the beginning here, where it was the Mass Council on Elderly, whether it was the Age Strong Commission in the Boston, whether it was housing, whether it was John Barrows talking about economic development, every single person in this film is the leading cast person, because the topic of that moment was the most important topic of that day.
Well, and I'm going to be careful in choosing my adjective, Fred, but you seem in effect invisible in every meeting. And I mean that in a complimentary way. But people don't act like, to what the mayor's observing, the people really don't seem to act like they know that you're there. And in many ways, if for anyone who's seen your many remarkable films, that's really a part of your signature style, to achieve that ability to observe. Can you talk to us about how you accomplish that? How do you create that ability?
Well, I think people are distracted by my big ears. The only thing that I'm conscious of doing is I try to demystify the process of filmmaking. So I, if there's time, I explain what I'm doing and how I'm doing it and where the film will be shown. In the case of City Hall, I mean, I had a chance, I think a notice went out to the employees that I was, people who worked there, that I was making a film. Before any meeting was shot, if anybody had any questions, it was the first time they'd seen me, I would explain what I was doing. I did whatever I could to demystify the process. And it's very important to always answer any questions that come up very directly and honestly. Because if people had the sense that I was conning them, it would be a mistake on my part and would ruin the film, because there would be a bit of suspicion created, or more than a bit of suspicion created. So the technique, if there is one, is to be direct and just to stay out of the way. And also, I think that, I mean, there's an old question that's frequently debated, whether the camera changes people's behavior. In my view, it doesn't. I think if people don't want to be filmed, they'll say no, or they'll thumb their noses or walk away. But if they agree to be filmed, most of us aren't good enough actors to suddenly change our behavior. You know, we're not all Meryl Streep. So that if we agree to be filmed, we basically go about our business.
Well, one of the remarkable things to me about the film is the many in-person experiences the audience has afforded in being in lots of different meetings and rooms and discussions in Boston with the community in Boston, often in conversation with Mayor Walsh's staff, and you know, which for GBH and for public media is very well aligned with, you know, our commitment to telling authentic stories from diverse voices. It's an important part of what we do, and often giving people a window onto the world around them that they might not already have, to bring them up close. And your films are remarkable and distinctive in doing that. We in the public media sphere, we don't tell people what to think. We provide them hopefully with facts, experiences, and insights, and hopefully have them inform their own judgment on things. Fred, unfiltered voices of everyday people without narration or titles are such an essential feature of, frankly, all your films. What types of stories are you looking for? You've made 45 films. You've had to, you know, decide where you would put your attention and passion. What are you looking for, and what subjects move you? How do you make that decision that an institution is worth your attention and time?
Well, I mean, the model for me is Las Vegas. Each film is a roll of the dice because I usually don't know much about what goes on in advance. And I take the risk that if I spend 10 weeks at City Hall or at a model agency or at a welfare center or with a police department or whatever the subject might be, that in that time, if I'm lucky enough and patient enough, I'll accumulate enough footage out of which I can cut a film. And the shooting of the film is really the research, because I really don't know anything about it. I don't like to be at a place before I start shooting, because without being ready to shoot, because something great might go on and I'd miss it. And so that I'm once there, once I have permission, I like to film. Really what I'm interested in is human behavior. Mm-hmm. And making a series of films about institutions allows me to make films about human behavior in well-defined situations, because the institutions are run according to certain rules. There are certain historical practices, and there are encounters between the people who live in the community and the people are responsible for the administration of the community. So it's the institution is really a pretext to have a look at as wide a range of human behavior as I can.
Well, speaking about storytelling, Mr. Mayor, you know, telling, I was reminded as I watched the film that telling your own personal life story is a recurring element in your own speeches and your way of connecting with your constituents. You're very comfortable drawing upon your life experiences. Can you talk about the importance to you of storytelling in governing and connecting with your constituents? Because in a way, you're your own storyteller.
No, thank you. You know, public service is about people. As mayor, I want to try and humanize everything that we do here at City Hall so people understand. It's a big part of being open and sharing my own personal experiences. You know, my parents are immigrants from Ireland. They came here in the 50s with nothing. I had cancer as a kid. You know, my family and our neighbors went through hard times. I'm a recovering alcoholic, so I struggle with alcoholism. I share my stories so people feel better about being able to talk about what challenges they might be having, and that they open up and we can help them with that. You know, I think it's really important that people understand that what they might have in common with their mayor or with other people that I work with every day. I think. You know, we're a city made up of 20% immigrant, 28% of the people in the city are immigrants. 48% are first generation like I am. 50% of people of color. And when you think about the diversity of the administration and what's talked about throughout the film, you know, we want to, our government isn't about the name on the door. It's not about whose name is on top of the word mayor out there. It's about the people that work for the city of Boston. And I think telling my story, I think it is really important to be able to try and help people. And that's kind of how I do it. I mean, I can't identify and relate to every situation that comes my way or our way in the city. But I do think it's important that people understand who I am and what I'm all about and my lived experiences in my past. To make that connection to people. I find it so important. Like I often talk to people, like when I'm talking about prescription drugs, I'm not just an elected official talking about prescription drugs and the need for programming. I talk about my father's story when he was on a drug for his prostate, and you know, I learned about the donut hole back, you know, 15 years ago, what the donut hole was. I didn't know what the donut hole was. And the donut hole was seniors to pay the first $2,500. They have to pay $2,500 out of pocket, and then the rest is paid by insurance. And like, having them understand that I know the struggles they're going through, even though I'm not living them myself personally, is really important.
Well, Fred, I want to follow up a little bit about the kind of everyday aspects of the city. And while the film is called City Hall, it's not only about City Hall. It's really an ode to the sights, sounds, and architecture of Boston and its diverse neighborhoods, really to its everyday life and its beauty. I was mesmerized by that long scene of the road workers. I didn't know what they were doing at first. It was a puzzle. The road workers making that red bus lane strip. And also one that I've actually gotten a bunch of notes about, the sanitation workers crushing that mattress, then the jaws of that sanitation truck. You make something so mundane into art. Can you say a little bit about, and you mentioned your edit process, what appeal do these scenes have for you? And why did you decide to include these? Because a lot of the magic obviously comes when you decide ultimately what structure to put to it and what shots to choose and why. But can you say a little bit about those scenes and what you chose and why?
Sure. Well, those, both the arranging the lane, the bus lane, and the garbage collection sequence were opportune. I mean, they serve a variety of purposes in the film. First of all, they show the workers the work of collecting garbage, which is an important function or responsibility of the city. And they show workers constructing bus lanes, which is, something that that reflects the transportation policy of the city. But beyond that, they represented film opportunities, because each of those scenes is made up a number of shots, as contrasted with a meeting, for example, where a meeting, people are talking, and you have to keep the camera off and just on the person that's talking for a minute or a minute and a half. Whereas those two scenes, I could try to make more visually interesting than a meeting scene, because there's movement. And I tried to cut the garbage collection scene to give a sense of the rhythm of the work. And so that it's made up of a whole bunch of short shots. The truck coming down the street, the worker pressing a button on the truck, the vast claw that chews everything up coming down, a quick shot of a mattress or a grill being thrown in, the noise of the great claw, the great teeth of the truck chewing up whatever is put in. I mean, the mic had to be put right into the truck, right near the teeth, in order to get, you know, to give a sense of the sound. It's shot and it's edited to try and recreate the feeling of the event, and make a film event out of it. It's not a document. I mean, for example, if I wanted to show that there was garbage collection in Boston, I could have had a wide shot of the garbage truck coming down the street, and a medium shot of the worker dumping something into the back of the truck, and then the truck pulling out. So I could then check the list, garbage collection. But the effort is always to make it visually interesting.
Well, I think I teased you in advance, Fred, that I've gotten three or four notes about the garbage truck scene. And two of them, they said, you know, it was peculiarly satisfying to watch the jaws of that truck take out that mattress. So you did with the sound boom, you obviously got it done. I didn't know that about how close you had to get the microphone, but it sure worked for a lot of people. I think that'll be one of the many memorable parts of the film. You know, I was also struck by the recurring theme in the film of the ongoing need for equity and opportunity and access. And there are scenes obviously reflecting commitment to our schools, in veterans affairs, in small business ownership, in elder care, in neighborhoods deciding what businesses are coming in and how and why, and in housing. Mayor Walsh, your administration has made a commitment to ending systemic racism and disparities. And I'd welcome the chance to have each of you speak a little bit to that, because this is, the film so well reveals the kind of the full life of the city. And it's and in a range of neighborhoods and in a range of people at various stages of life and circumstance. I'd love to, you know, really appreciate hearing you, Mr. Mayor, talk a little bit about that commitment to equity and opportunity. And Fred, if you're comfortable talking a little bit about what you ended up accomplishing with the film in that respect, that would be great too. Mayor Walsh?
Thank you. Yeah, you know, what's interesting is that throughout the film, there's lots of discussion about inequality, equity, whether it's in housing or economic development. In this film, people need to remember was filmed before George Floyd was killed. So all across this country, systemic racism has had a profound impact on people's well-being. We see it from housing to health outcomes. We're seeing it now front and center with COVID. True equality in America, American values, we have not realized it yet. And I mentioned Boston's a very diverse city, and we've spent the last several years working on the issues, creating opportunities for people of color, focusing on closing the income gap. GBH has done many stories on the income gap, and I've talked to on Jim and Marjorie as well, making sure that every single resident has access to healthcare and health and safety and fulfillment. And so you think about that, we've been doing this since 2014 to say 2020. And after the murder of George Floyd, it was clear that we have so much more to do as a nation, but also as a city. This is about life and death. And in Boston, we're approaching it with the urgency it deserves. This is more than a moment. This is something that we really have to just can't do something in the moment. And I think that during the film, I mean, the work is happening in all different departments, in all different aspects of what people are watching. But since that time, you know, we brought on the chief of equity. We're taking a look at the way we governed in City Hall and seeing what was working, what wasn't working, and what do we have to do after City Hall, meaning after the movie. And it's completely, it's going to change. The sense of urgency, the being the right time. I mean, this is the time now we have to do even more than we've done in the past. And I'm kind of, you know, what the way I'm going to use Fred's film is we will be able to look at pre-pandemic in the way that we did our business. And a lot of people find it really interesting and they love it. And what's it going to look like post-pandemic? So I'm going to use this film as an opportunity to learn and use this film as an opportunity to strengthen our city and our outcomes, but in particular, strengthen the systemic changes. When we talk about systemic racism, it's systemic changes in policies. And that's really what we have to focus on. And this film can be in some ways a guide to us on how we handle it and how we move forward.
And Fred, you obviously have a lens through all of your films, you've revealed the life circumstances of folks, of people across a range of professions, community circumstances, life and family circumstances. You've really, I'm thinking about a number of the films that have moved me, you've just revealed a part of the world that often is outside our gaze. Do you want to say anything about what the film accomplishes in kind of maybe widening the aperture of the way people understand their own community?
Well, I mean, I can say what it did for me, because as I think I mentioned earlier, I knew nothing about city government. You know, I think I'd probably been in City Hall once. I didn't know anybody that worked there. I had no connection with Boston politics. For the last 20 years or so, I haven't lived a good part of the year in France. so that I started the film with a clear but empty head. And what you see in the film is what I learned. And I was appreciative of the access that I had. But I learned the wide range of very complex issues that the mayor and his staff have to deal with. I began to have some appreciation of the complexity of the task and the fact that the mayor is like a conductor of a symphony orchestra. And he has to know what all his departments are doing, what the relationship is between the departments. And he has to, and the end result has to be the creation of good government, putting aside the question of what that might mean. It's an enormously complex, demanding, and constantly changing work. And what I tried to do in the film is to show my appreciation for that work and to give some sense of how it was accomplished.
When you think about the final work, Fred, and what you accomplished, and you think, this is always a challenging question to ask a filmmaker, when you think of, you, in a way you may have already answered it, but what would you like your audience for the film to take away from City Hall? What insights, what lessons?
And it's hard to say it in 25 words or less, but, you know, having said that, I'll give it a whirl. I think greater appreciation for the effort and complexity of the task and admiration for the people who are working the issues.
And well, I could say, having screened the film and really appreciated what must have gone into the choices you were making. You certainly accomplished that, as those who've seen it at the film festivals have already observed and noted. So thank you. I want to go a little bit behind the scenes, because I'm familiar with a little bit of the exercise, Fred, that where you were saying, look, a City Hall subject seems like it might be fitting. And so you approached a group of cities. I don't know exactly how many, but somehow, and I remember hearing from you that you had conferred with the city of Boston, with Mayor Walsh, and that you had access. And of course, my immediate question was, wow, what was that process like? So can you say a little bit about the handful of cities you might have approached and kind of what the circumstances were of
there was
Boston saying yes, and then from Mayor Walsh's point of view, it must have been an interesting question coming his way about having Fred Wiseman want to come do your City Hall.
Well, I mean, I'd wanted to do a City Hall for a long time, and I hadn't done it. And then there was an article in the New York Times that talked about the best mayors, six of the best mayors in the country. I'm always more interested in picking a place, or when I can, picking a place as a subject of the film where the people are trying and are doing a good job, because that's more complex and more interesting. And so I wrote, Boston was among them, and I wrote to the other cities. I got two turn downs, and I think three no answers. And the letter I wrote to the mayor was originally opened by his administrative assistant, who passed it on to Joyce Linehan, who was head of policy planning. And I lucked out in that Joyce had seen some of my films and liked them. So she asked me and Karen Konacek, who's worked with me for 40 years, to come in and talk to them. And I did. And much to my very pleasant surprise, they said, okay. And so that was, I think, in the spring, late spring of 2018. And then I started shooting in that fall.
I remember when you...
But it was sheer good luck. I mean, if the person that opened the letter had also seen some of my films, and so she enthusiastically turned it over to Joyce.
Well, you did somehow somewhere get some no's, but you got a yes from Boston. I remember when you telling me that Boston had said yes. Mr. Mayor, what do you remember that sequence and perhaps Joyce walking in and kind of pitching this notion to you?
Joyce came into me and she started talking about Fred Wiseman and who he is and what he does. Basically I didn't have a decision at first. I said to myself, as I said, opening here, do we want to open us up to potential criticism? What's it going to be? What's the final movie? And asked all those questions. And Joyce was like, well, we're not sure. It's going to be about City Hall. And I'm like, what does that mean? And then we talked to Fred and he's basically said the same thing. I'm not sure what it's going to be, but this is what I want to do. And I honestly think that, at the end of the day, I did some research on Fred and just an incredible filmmaker. And so he's legit at the time thinking that. And secondly, what harm could come of promoting Boston City Hall and city government? And I think that, it's a way for us to promote our city. So we ultimately said yes. And I'm grateful for it. And I'm grateful for it, not because of all the recognition Fred's getting. I'm grateful for it because of getting to know Fred and his team. And even just looking at the scenes when Fred talked about just now, when you guys are talking about the trash or talking about the bike lanes, the bus lanes, that's government. That's government. And that's about, it's complex. And if that trash truck isn't moving and isn't picking trash up, then the government that people expect isn't happening, because there's a problem in the administration. And every piece of it, it's like a tire. Every piece of every spoke, every piece has to work. And if there's a breakdown in the spoke, there's a breakdown in the system. If there's a breakdown in the system, there's potentially a breakdown in democracy. And that democracy in this particular case is municipal government.
Well, I was thinking about it this morning, knowing I'd be on with both of you. Of course, after Boston gets blanketed with snow, I realized if Fred was still filming, he'd be out there with a snowplow, because that was today's challenge for you and your team, Mr. Mayor. I'm going to take us to, we've got some great questions from the audience. So if I can, I'd like to turn it over to our audience a bit and explore some of their questions. Susan from Boston had a question for you, Mr. Mayor. What is the one thing Mayor Walsh would change in the movie?
Oh,
Fred is covering his ears.
God, I probably wouldn't have been in a suit and tie every scene. No, seriously, I think you just mentioned it. There's two things I would like to add to the movie if we could. One is yesterday's Nor'easter. I think Fred would have loved seeing our public health department out there working, clearing the streets and the system. You start with the salting, and then you start with the snow plowing, and then you start with the removal, and then you start with the salting at the end to get you down a bare pavement. And then with coronavirus, different this year, we weren't able to gather, and the precautions that were put in place. I think that would have been an incredible sequence of events to watch. And the second one is the election. The national election, as we were all sitting on our hands waiting for these absentee ballots to be counted in these early votes all across the country, including Boston, at 9 o'clock on election night on Tuesday, our election department had put in 167,000 mail-in ballots in the system. We had everything counted by 9 o'clock. There was no recounts and there was no waiting and it was ready to go. And I think even that system, I would love, it's unfortunate, but those two areas that people would have seen that impacted them in the last 30 days, if you will, election and that. So I, that's the only thing I think I would have loved to have seen added to the film. I would never tell Fred, this should have been in there, that shouldn't have been there. That's not my job. My job is just to be the mayor, and that's Fred. So those two scenes, I think Fred would have really, you would have loved to.
You're right. Well,
Fred, I've got a question for you. Gene from Dorchester asks, Fred, so much of media today is quick sound bites. And this is a film that's a little over 4 hours long. Why do you think the longer format is better, or what over time, I think, in effect, what does a long format allow you to accomplish that obviously isn't typically in the diets of everyday Americans these days with the media?
Well, the subjects I pick to make movies about are complicated subjects. And I think I have an obligation to the people who've given me permission to make as accurate a reflection of the complexity of their work as I can. And so, as far as I know, God didn't decide that a film had to be 53 minutes or 84 minutes. Some network executive decided that. My films come out at a length that I think appropriately reflects the material. I've always pushed very hard, and public television has been wonderful to me in that they've always, you have always shown the films at the length that I deliver them. And I'm grateful for that, among many other things, for the continued support that I get from public television. But the short answer to the question is that these are complex subjects. I think they can't be adequately dealt with in sound bites. Sometimes it's difficult to adequately deal with them in 4.5 hours.
And Mr. Mayor, I'm going to introduce a question kind of from me based on what you've both shared so far, kind of puts you on the spot, Mayor Walsh. When you looked at the film, you talked about the couple things that you might add. I was kind of curious, you get a sense that your hand and fingers are on the pulse of the various aspects, of course, of the city government, your team, who's looking after what issues. There were some great meetings that were captured by Fred that you're not present for. And I was wondering if there were some particular scenes or a scene that stood out to you as the most revealing or surprising to you, despite the fact that I know you're very attentive to everything that's going on in your city, but there must have been something that maybe popped for you that surprised you in what it shared and revealed.
Yeah, so when I watched the film, and there was lots of meetings, and there was some events like with seniors, and there was other events where I was talking to people. There was lots of internal meetings, but there was one scene with Sheila Dillon in housing, and she was at a table, people were talking, and I initially thought it was a internal meeting of staff talking about policy or whatever, talking about the whatever policy or whatever it was. And it, as the camera spanned the crowd, I realized it was an activist meeting. And what I thought about there was the honesty of that scene, where people aren't going to hold back, and they're going to say exactly what they feel, because they don't, like Fred said earlier, they don't care if a camera's on, they don't even see the camera, they're concerned about the issue. And I thought to myself at that point, I knew that this was something special, because there was no editing and cutting of controversial, so-called potential controversial. And that struck me that this movie really is about how government really does work. And we get caught up in the titles, and we get caught up in the, Democrats versus Republicans, the governor, the mayor, the reps and stuff. This is actually government working. And it shows that, we are like a business or a nonprofit, that we need to have all aspects moving forward. And in that scene, it showed that.
Well, one of my other favorite scenes is the discussion. I was intrigued in the same way that you were surprised there about, is this an internal meeting? Oh no, it's an external meeting. I was intrigued with Fred's capturing that discussion about South Station and about the circumstance of how do you manage a population that's finding their way into South Station overnight, and what are the counter arguments or the various stakeholders who are wrestling with how do we find shelter for people, and the teamwork between the transit police representative and your housing people, and that sense of how are these various agencies kind of talking to each other to try to figure out what a solution could be.
Every day, a film could be made in City Hall of something. When you think about that, you think about the four the film, this film, four hours, it's half a work day. But every day, in every department, in every space, we could make a movie, because these same things going on today. There's trash trucks in Boston picking up the trash. Maybe we're not painting and putting down bus lanes today because of the weather, but there's something else going on. Our public works department, our transportation department, our water and sewer, our parks department, our office of immigrant advancement, our office of women advancement, our office of Age Strong. Every day there's something going on in the city of Boston.
One of the things that the film does for me is remind, I hope it does for everybody who watches, it reminds us how grateful we all should be for the people who work so hard on just day to day on the things that keep everything running, as you say, that every step builds upon another step, and the interdependency of people working to solve problems for community residents. Fred, speaking of the fact that there's so many stories to tell, we got a great question from Linda Chin in Cambridge, your hometown, for you. Fred, how do you decide when a work is completed to your satisfaction?
Probably when I want to go home. I'm sick of motel life. But I during the shooting, I keep track. I look at rushes every night. And I have a notebook in my pocket, and I've kept a list of what I think are the major sequences or the sequences that I like. And at a certain point, I have 100 or 150, or in some case of at Berkeley, I had 250 hours of rushes. And I figure, enough's enough. I should be able to cut a film out of that. And my movies are made up of thousands, if not tens of thousands, or maybe even hundreds of thousands of subjective choices. And the choice of when to quit is one among those thousands.
And when you mentioned Berkeley, and I'm thinking about New York Public Library and some of the other institutions that you've looked at, when I was thinking about you tackling City Hall and in effect the city, it just seems, I understand UC Berkeley was a big, it's a big campus with a lot of stories and constituencies, but gosh, tackling City Hall and a city and the kind of spokes out of City Hall, did that present any particular challenges in kind of scope for you in trying to figure out how to wrap your arms around the range of stories that come out of city government?
Yeah, well, it was either naive or pretentious of me to try. But I thought I would give it a whirl. And I think even at 4.5 hours, the film only begins to suggest the complexity of the subject matter. I was taken with the vastness of the subject. But since I'm a gambler, I thought, why not? Give it a whirl. See how it comes out.
Well, one question we had also is from obviously a fan of yours. Samuel from Newton Center, Massachusetts, wants to know, how can we access Mr. Wiseman's other documentaries and films? It is true, Fred. Once you've seen one Fred Wiseman film, you are understandably curious about how your approach translates to other subjects. And each of us, when we have a chance to read a review of one of your films, there are always references to your other landmark projects. So I think that's a fair question. Can you say a little bit more?
I'm delighted the question was asked. Yes, all my films are distributed on DVD by my company, Zipporah Films, which Karen Konachak runs. And they're also available on VOD through most public libraries in the country that subscribe to a company called Canopy, K-A-N-O-P-Y. Those are the Zipporah Films or through a public library.
Yeah, I'd love to, I'm grateful that you've done that with Canopy, K-A-N-O-P-Y. I think that, speaking of another public institution, and I know public libraries are something that are very important to Mayor Walsh as well. The Canopy effort, I thank you for mentioning that, because that we in public media really appreciate that greater access. So I'm thrilled. And of course, every once in a while, there are retrospectives of your films. The Museum of Fine Arts has done one here in Boston, and I know we've done one on World Channel. And gosh, I think it's time for you and me to talk about doing another one.
I'm all for it.
But I'm thrilled that with each project, it opens up curiosity about, particularly for younger viewers who may not have had an experience with some of your other work. So exciting that people have a chance to explore further your other films. Well, Mr. Mayor, let me put you on the spot one more time. Do you have, you've opened your doors, you and your team, to Fred Wiseman, the arguably one of the greatest filmmakers of his time, easily so. Do you have any final words for Fred now that you've seen the film and you took this journey saying yes at the beginning?
I think Fred knows how I feel about him personally. He's a wonderful person. Fred also had a little medical mishap while the filming was going on, so he had to take a couple weeks off, and he came back, and I was worried about him. And I just want to say, Fred, as I said in the beginning, I love reading the reviews. You deserve every single one of them. You deserve all of the credit and the recognition that you get for being an incredible filmmaker. And I want to thank you for when John brought up the fact, or somebody brought the question up about the world today. We do everything in short clips. And the fact that you took the time and put something 4 hours, people are like, 4 hours long? Yeah, it's 4 hours long because it tells a story. And I want to thank you for telling the story. I want to thank you for, on behalf of all the people that work here in City Hall, for telling the story of what they do every day and to put some trust back into government. And that's what we need today. We need more trust. And you've done that with this film. So I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Well, and I want to thank you for taking the risk of giving me access. It was a grand pleasure for me to make the film, and I learned an enormous amount. And I have great admiration for what you and the staff at City Hall do.
Thank you, my friend.
Well, with that, I'm afraid we're out of time. I'm so grateful that Fred could join us coming in from Paris, and I'm grateful that the internet held up so that we could, in this period where we're all reaching each other digitally, the mayor could carve out time, I know, from what must be a busy day with all the things that are going on in the city today, for both of you to spend some time talking to us about Fred's film, City Hall. I want to share again what a pleasure it is to be with both of you. And we are very proud to be able to let everyone know that we are premiering Fred Wiseman's City Hall on public television here in Boston on GBH2 next Tuesday, December 22nd at 8 p.m. It'll also gratefully be on PBS stations across the country. So, Mr. Mayor, I get to kind of fluff up with a little bit of pride for Boston, because Indianapolis, San Diego, Dallas, and Houston all have to watch a film about Boston City Hall. So we're proud that City Hall will be on the air on PBS and public media across the country. And I should also mention, when Fred talked about access, one of the other things that's exciting for us is, as friends tell friends about the film, that we will also be streaming Fred's film, City Hall, on the PBS app for 4 weeks after its premiere. So Fred has generously agreed such that we can continue to spread through word of mouth news of the film. And if somebody can't watch on Tuesday night, they have a chance to do it with through streaming. And that's for public media, it's a great resource, because when someone like Fred puts that kind of time, attention, and passion into a film, the old days of television, when you had to get it all done Tuesday night at 8 and hope that you had people choosing to tune in that moment, and then it was all done. Those days are fortunately in the past, because now we're gonna have that streaming availability of the film. So more experiences, hopefully more reach for the film. And that's, I think that's great for everybody. I also wanna thank everyone who's watching. Many of you are supporters of public media and of GBH, and it's important. I'd love to observe, as we wrap up the year, that if we didn't have our viewer support, our listener support in this community and in communities across the country, we couldn't make public media possible. And so we're very proud to be able to share Fred's film and how it illustrates the importance of our city government and the work of our city government and officials. But it's also our own version of a public-private partnership when our audiences support our ability to support work like this. So thank you for your support of GBH. If you're in the audience and are already doing it, we really thank you. Mr. Mayor, Fred Wiseman, thank you so much for generously giving of your time to be with our audience today. And I wish you both happy holidays and a peaceful new year. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Mayor Walsh.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Fred.